relax the abdomen, even the jaw and the cheeks, and the eyes can be soft. Then let's close the eyes, have our awareness inward, and be aware of the feeling or vibration created by chanting Om 3 times. Inhale. Om. Keeping your awareness inward, take a few deep breaths. In whatever way you know, deepen the breath so the exhale is very thorough, gently pulling in the abdomen. And the inhale that follows is filling the lungs all the way. Take a few more slow, conscious breaths that way. Then let the breath return to normal. And since we're sitting still, watch the breath fall into its own natural rhythm. And observe that rhythm. Then turn your attention to your own mind and thoughts. Just for a moment, feel as though you can step back from your thinking and you can watch what thoughts arise. Another friend, a Swami, says, let your thoughts be like guests at your party. Invite them all in. Just open the door and let every thought come that wants to come. But you stand back as the host, greet them, and invite them in.
That's a very, very useful practice that we'll talk more about as we look at this idea of working with our painful emotions and inner conflict. In order to work skillfully with them, we need to cultivate more and more awareness, more and more ability to be present to them, to see what feelings move in our hearts, and to accept them and work with them in healthy ways. It's a two-part workshop. Part two will be in 2 weeks, and we'll follow up a little bit from what we speak about tonight 2 weeks from now. But that will give us a chance to explore and work with the concepts that we talk about tonight over the next 2 weeks. So if you can join us again, June 27th, I invite you to come back. Start with a little bit of foundation for approaching this subject. The yoga masters help us understand that underneath all the movement of thought and all the sensations in the physical level, there is a natural source of unchanging peace, contentment, a sense of completeness that dwells within us as our true nature. It's not something that we need to acquire, it's a natural state. But of course, because we experience our physical and mental levels so fully, they so fully dominate our experience of who we are and how life is, that it's difficult sometimes to be in touch with this more subtle, though profound aspect of our being, the spiritual consciousness that all the yoga masters, and in a way, all the religions talk about, this consciousness, this presence of God, that's essentially who we are. But because we don't experience that, because we're raised in a culture that doesn't see things that way, we build a sense of ourselves based on these prevailing messages of the culture that tell us that as a body-mind, we're all separate from each other. And as separate, we need to acquire and achieve the things that will constitute happiness or success in life. So simply said, feeling like a separate body-mind, a lot of our lives become an effort to acquire the things or achieve the things that feel like they will make for a happy life. Right? Since we don't experience this natural kind of happiness that's already there, we think of doing things, achieving things, acquiring things that will bring that happiness. Right? Arranging things well enough in our lives that we can have a happy life. And that's the understanding that's prevailing in our culture, right? That if you can acquire these things or achieve these things, that makes for a happy life. And of course, just to be clear, there's nothing wrong with having a wonderful life full of beautiful things. There's nothing wrong with any of those things. The problem is only when we think that our happiness depends on them, and that it's only by acquiring or achieving things, only by controlling the world around us, that we find happiness. That's the mistake. Because if our happiness is based on things that go on around us, then there are things that come and go that we can't actually control. Who among us is able to control things the way we plan, arrange for everything to go as we like? This pandemic is another example of so many things that are out of our control that we never could have imagined, right? That have swept away our normal way of life. Jobs that seemed dependable have been lost. How many hundreds of thousands of people around the world have left this life, passed away from this illness that no one could have imagined even 6 months ago. So as long as there is impermanence, as long as that we're the body-mind are fragile and dependent on circumstances that are out of our control, there will be change. As long as we depend on keeping things the way we want, making things happen the way we want, we'll suffer. We'll experience disappointment and frustration and this relentless effort to try to make things work in a way that feels happy. Does all this make sense, what I'm saying so far? You can nod your head. And I'll invite you to unmute yourself and ask a question if at any point, or if you're not sure how to unmute yourself, just raise your hand. Because I do want to allow for some exchange in this workshop. So at any point, a question, please speak up. So correctly understood, emotions, all forms of emotions, are a natural part of the human experience. Right? Joy, love, awe at the miraculous nature around us, as well as depression, anxiety, grief over the losses that we experience. All those things are a natural part of human life until we find and dwell in a kind of unchanging happiness that's independent of circumstances. The problem that we experience as human beings is that there are so many messages in our culture telling us that emotions are a sign of weakness, even from a spiritual point of view, a kind of defect. They're not seen as something that's wholesome and healthy. And it's easy to fall into a habit of being judgmental and critical about our own emotions. So I've said that emotional pain is something natural, part of human experience. In a way, it's a powerful form of learning. Whenever we experience great anger or disappointment or anxiety, it tells us about how much we're counting on something as a source of happiness or as a source of peace of mind. Right? How important things are to us. Right? These are important messages for us to look at and to understand and can be powerful teachers for us on the spiritual path. But again, because of the influences of our culture, even the cliche, the phrase that probably everyone's familiar with, big boys don't cry, right? There's so many messages telling us that our emotional selves, our emotional feelings are not respected, are not appropriate. There's something that we need to keep in check and keep out of sight. So we develop a habit of criticizing them, judging them ourselves. So the emotion itself is a form of pain, you could say. Eckhart Tolle calls it the pain body that's made up of the unresolved painful emotions that we've experienced from the past that reside in ourselves. Another author that I really appreciate, Thich Nhat Hanh, some of you would be familiar with, a Buddhist Vietnamese teacher. He calls them internal formations, like a psychic knot that gets tied up inside of us. Right? When we are unable to skillfully appreciate and work with our emotional pain, when we layer on top of it a kind of criticism or judgment or denial, because it's uncomfortable, because it's unattractive, right? We have that tendency to block it out of our consciousness, to rationalize it, or just simply to deny it. When I was thinking about this, I recalled a poem from one of my favorite poets, the mystical Middle Eastern poet Rumi, that many of you would be familiar with. And he has a poem that you may have heard before called the guest house that I'll read. The poem goes this way. This being human is a guest house, every morning a new arrival, a joy, a depression, a meanness. Some momentary awareness comes as an unexpected visitor. Welcome and entertain them all, even if they're a crowd of sorrows who violently sweep your house empty of its furniture. Still, treat each guest honorably. He may be clearing you out for some new delight. The dark thought, the shame, the malice, meet them at the door laughing and invite them in. Be grateful for whoever comes, because each has been sent as a guide from beyond. It's a very powerful poem. A little difficult to hear and take to heart. Even to look at our painful emotions is not fun. It's easy for us to take on the judgmental attitude of our culture and to feel uncomfortable with or critical of our own emotion. I remember once when I was talking to someone whose mother had passed away some time before, and he was saying, he said to me at one point in the conversation, I know I should be over it by now. I shouldn't be grieving anymore. And I thought to myself, is that really true? Is there a time frame? Is there a timeline by which you should no longer grieve? And I think that's an issue. How do we know what's the right amount of time to experience an emotion? How do we know when it should be done? How do we know that we shouldn't have it? I think these are more ideas that come from the culture around us more than a reality. As long as we feel something, it's important for us to be able to look at it. Because only by looking at it, only by accepting it, and allowing ourselves to experience those feelings, do we have a chance to resolve them, to bring them to the surface, and to release them from our hearts. An analogy I like to use when I'm thinking about this is physical pain. We know that when we have physical pain, we can relieve the pain with what we call pain relievers or painkillers, right? And that will temporarily take away the pain. But we know that doesn't get to the cause of the pain. It's a temporary relief from it, but it doesn't remove the cause. So in addition to relieving pain, we want to ultimately find the cause. Isn't it so? And if we can't figure out what's the cause of my pain, we even go to someone, we call a doctor, and ask the doctor if they can help us understand the cause and remove the cause. Is it not so? I like having a physical audience right here in front of me so that we can react, but we'll have to do with some head shaking and things like that. Good, thank you. So in the same way, when we look deeply into the cause of our pain to try to understand the roots, right, and then we have a chance to remove that cause, in the same way we need to look deeply into the cause of our emotional pain. Right? And that's where so much inner conflict gets in the way. Right? By inner conflict, I often think of We have one kind of feeling, it exists, but we have another idea about what should be, and the two are not matching up. So I'll go through what I would consider a number of steps for working in a healthy way with our emotional issues, right? Especially our emotional pain. Right? And I'll do some of those steps today, and we'll do some guided reflection. And then in 2 weeks, we'll look a little deeper at some of the things that we can learn and the way that we could, what I call, receive the messages of our emotions and make changes based on receiving those messages. But let's start with these steps. And the first step I've kind of talked about already, the first step in my mind is simply developing an ability and accepting awareness, an ability to accept what's coming up. An ability to look at it and welcome it. And that's why I wanted to practice some mindfulness in the beginning of this workshop. And while I'll suggest that we practice again toward the end of this workshop today, a meditative practice. Because in meditation, we simply stand apart from all the movement of thought and allow it to be. Right? We don't sort through the thoughts that come up. We don't decide or make choices about them. We simply stand apart from them. And we may redirect our attention onto a focal point, like a mantra or the breath, but we don't try to fix the thoughts. Right? We don't try to manipulate them. We let them be what they are. We simply disconnect from them. And there's something healthy about building that ability. It doesn't mean that we deny the thoughts. It simply means that we don't identify ourselves with those thoughts. Meaning that we need not feel that we are the anger or the fear. We need not identify ourselves in a shameful way, in a guilty way, with our depression or our anger. Right? We can allow those to be a part of our human experience. That's the beauty of the heart. Right? So much of our human life gears us to be in the head, reasoning, planning, judging, measuring. So many of the ways that we cope with life in this modern day world have to do with the technology of living in this world, especially now, right? How many people here, if I can have a show of hands, have had to learn new ways of working with technology by step going through the right? Oh my gosh, I got two hands up. So much of our modern life requires that of us, right? And that gets us a lot in the head. Stuck in the head, planning and measuring and judging and doing everything right, saving all your passwords in a spreadsheet so that you know for each website that you go into where you're a member, you can find the corresponding password. Oh my gosh. I have this Excel spreadsheet now, and I have to scan through to find the password for the banking online, and on. So stuck in the head, we separate ourselves from the heart. Right? We lose the ability to bring our heart as a presence to ourselves. Right? And that's one of the reasons that yoga emphasizes the practice of Hatha Yoga, the practice of asana and pranayamas, to bring awareness to the body, to open our hearts to the body as it is. So correctly understood, asana practice is not meant to impose on the body how we'd like it to be so that we can look like the cover of Yoga Journal. Right? so that we can look like the teacher or anybody else. Hatha yoga asana practiced correctly, in harmony with its original purpose, is done as a way of being sensitive to what is. And that's a beautiful foundation for us, for skillfully working with the mind as well, right? By allowing the heart to lead, to be present, to embrace what is, right? To accept what is. To me, that's the first step, is to accept what's there. I remember years ago, I lived in San Francisco many years ago in the late 1980s. And then I lived in New York for 20 years in the 90s and up until 2011. But I remember I went to a talk by the spiritual teacher Ram Dass that many of you would be familiar with. Baba Ram Dass, he might be called. His first book was called Be Here Now. And he wrote a number of other books. He's still teaching, even though he's been partially paralyzed. But I remember going to hear him speak, and I never forget something that he talked about that struck me, that I still remember it. He was talking about his own experiences as a human being, and his own anger, the fact that he experienced anger and anxiety and depression. But he said, when I do experience those things, I try to treat them as a friend. And I think to myself, oh, there's anger. Oh, please, come in, have a seat, tell me what you're all about. Right? And that was so striking to me, that instead of feeling ashamed of an emotion that we would consider unspiritual, that he would have that beautiful accepting awareness of it and explore what it had to teach him. That was a big lesson for me, because I think I grew up being ashamed of my unhealthy emotions. Now we come to see there's no such thing as unhealthy emotions. There's no such thing as negative emotions, just part of the human experience. So to me, that's a major element of working with our emotions skillfully, is to develop this accepting awareness, to invite them in, to be present to them. And of course, that can be difficult if the emotion is very strong, if it's scary. If there's some emotion tied to some very painful event or traumatic event from the past, that can be quite difficult. So I don't want to gloss over that as if it's such an easy thing. So an important element of accepting and being willing to look more deeply into our emotion is to have some element of safety. And that's probably why many people, when they're struggling with some emotional difficulty, go to a friend that they really trust, or go to a therapist, right, who's an objective person who can be present to them with care, who can listen without judging and criticizing. Not everyone has that kind of a presence in their lives that's available to them. But I would suggest that that's an important element of learning to accept and then explore our emotions, is having that element of safety. Have you ever seen how a child, when it's lost its mother, it might almost be crying as someone, a stranger, helps it look for its mother? But once it's in the arms of its mother, then it will cry, right? Because then it's finally safe to completely express what it's feeling. You know, children are great role models for us when it comes to emotions. They don't have a story about their emotion. They don't have a layer of criticism or self-consciousness on top of the emotion. They just have the emotion. So I want to, I guess I'm spending a lot of time talking about this, what I would consider the importance of developing that accepting awareness, and then creating the circumstances that make it feel safe enough in order to look more deeply or experience that emotion. And maybe that's a next step, to actually allow ourselves to experience the feeling itself. As long as we push away a feeling, as long as we layer some judgment on top of a feeling, we don't actually experience the sensation of the feeling itself. In a way, I think of emotions as powerful thought forms. They're powerful enough that they resonate through all the different levels of our being. Right? They create a physical sensation that corresponds to that thought form. They vibrate through all the levels. And if we repress in any way that the energy that's generated by that emotion, then it becomes stuck inside of us, right? Tied up inside of us, and it binds up our energy. And it leaks out in various ways at different times. Have you seen people that kind of explode with anger in a small way, explode with anger in response to something very small, right, that happens to them? Right? It's like the straw that broke the camel's back. It's that one extra thing that pushes someone over the edge or triggers an emotion to come up. I remember coming back from a movie maybe 15 or 20 years ago when I was living in New York. And the movie was kind of had a sad moment in it. You know how we all kind of tear up a little bit at the sad moment in the movie. But as we were walking back, I was walking back with some friends, I could feel that something, that sad moment in the movie kind of really touched a deeper place of sadness in me. And I didn't know what it was, I didn't know how to talk about it, but I could feel it. And if I went back and visualized that moment in the movie, it really was sparking something. It was lighting on that locked-in formation or knot inside of myself. So when I got home from the movie, I remember taking a shower, and during the shower, when I felt alone and like there was no one around, I felt safe enough to cry. I just revisited that scene in the movie, and sure enough, I cried for a while. And I couldn't really understand why I was crying. I don't remember anything that made me sad. It's just the movie brought up the feeling. And every time I revisited that part of the movie, the feeling would keep, the energy from that emotion would keep moving. And I cried for quite a while, kind of surprising myself. And afterwards, I felt such a great relief, like, oh, that was interesting. And I never did, in that moment, I never did figure out what was behind that sadness, but I'm quite sure it was something from long before that had still been locked inside of me. And it was only kind of triggered by that sadness in the movie that I got in touch with that. And I think it was only because I was feeling comfortable enough with my emotions that I was able to allow myself to feel it. So that's another step besides developing this habit of accepting the emotions and understanding the importance of them. Another step is allowing ourselves to experience them and finding whatever safety we need in order to allow that feeling to express itself. And by that, I don't mean that when we're angry, we beat a pillow with our fists. I mean, that might provide some kind of temporary energetic release, but it doesn't really get to the emotion itself. To really get to the emotion itself, we have to allow ourselves to viscerally feel what that emotion is all about, how it expresses. Right? And probably a very good way to do that is to feel the emotion in the physical body. The mind has so many stories about our emotions, judgments, as I've talked about, ideas, rationalizations, why it should or shouldn't be, or even ways of dismissing an emotion by accounting for it in some way rationally. Oh, that was because of that. Just putting some thoughts on top of the emotion to explain it to ourselves. It's very handy when we can explain our emotions to ourselves rather than actually feel them. But it's simply another way of avoiding them. Some emotion that's still wrapped up inside of us needs to express, it needs to move, that energy needs to move. And the body is a beautiful way to be in touch with it. As the body doesn't have a story or a judgment, it simply is. It feels what it feels. So if we can call to mind some situation that brings up a feeling that's difficult or painful, and really go into the body and see what it feels like in the body, that can be a great way to begin allowing the energy of an emotion to express. I can give another example, also from my life in New York. There was a woman living in the Institute in New York back in the 1990s that I got to know a little bit because we lived in the same institute together. And at one point, in the midst of a number of different interactions that we had, she said to me, "I can see that you're lying to me about this situation." And I was surprised because I wasn't lying. I was surprised that she came to that conclusion. She didn't seem to be asking me. She was clear that I was lying. And while I can put a spin on the truth as well as anyone, in this particular situation, I wasn't lying. And I tried to explain myself to her. And she said, "Now you're just making up more lies to cover up your first lie." So I felt righteously indignant, maybe mildly angry, and I could see no reason to continue to talk to her about that situation. And I kind of walked away in a huff. Can you picture my huff? Like, well. And I went back to my desk, supposedly to work, but in the back of my mind as I was trying to work, I was kind of stewing this, or simmering in this kind of low-grade anger, irritation, indignation that she could think that way unfairly about me, be judging me like that. And I was thinking of her as the cause of my, I don't know, I was thinking of her as the problem. This person, why was she doing this? Why was she thinking that way? And kind of directing my disapproval, my irritation at her. And my teacher, Swami Satchidananda, used to say, when you direct your judgment at someone else, and he would put his finger this way, right? Then there's one finger pointing at them, and there's three fingers pointing at you. You point one finger at somebody else, there's three pointed at you. And there's a witness. So, as I sat there for a while, kind of feeling that low-grade anger, I finally realized, okay, I need to look at what's happening here. I need to look within myself. So I stopped thinking about her and just looked within myself to try to understand what was happening. And I thought to myself, okay, I need to see why I'm angry. And pretty quickly I could see that beneath the anger I was actually hurt. More than I was angry, I was actually hurt. As long as I stayed in the mode of like blaming her as a bad person for judging me unfairly, I felt the anger. Right? That was mostly about her. But as soon as I just got in touch with myself, I could see that beneath that anger, right, beneath that sort of layer on top of the hurt that I placed, was this feeling of being offended, of being hurt in the heart. Like, oh, she thinks that way of me. Right? She doesn't trust me. She thinks I'm lying. I was sad to have someone thinking that way about me. So that was an important lesson for me also. It wasn't a terrible situation. It wasn't a traumatic event, right? As so many emotional difficulties can be. So it was a small enough thing that in a short time I kind of understood that what was underneath the anger was hurt. And even if I looked into the hurt, I could begin to understand where it came from. That really what gave rise to the hurt was my desire, my hope, my expectation that she would trust me. I'm trying to be a fair-minded, trustworthy person, and she couldn't see me that way, and that hurt my feelings. What gave rise to the hurt was my expectation, my hope, or my desire that she would trust me, that I would be seen that way. That's the way that I think of myself, and that's the way I want to be seen. That's the self-image I'm trying to create and project to the world. I'm a trustworthy person. But she couldn't see it that way. And ultimately, I had to learn that I can't base the way I feel on the way that she thinks about me. For some reason, in that moment, she was unable to see me in a different way. She was unable to see the truth in that moment, right? For some reason of her own, right? And maybe in part two, I'll talk about that a little bit, because I learned more about her in the future. Meaning, much later, I learned about her. Well, maybe I'll speak about it now since I mentioned it. Much later, I learned that she grew up with a father who deceived her. Right? So in conversations, maybe a year later, she described to me how her father often deceived her. And as I looked back on that situation where she couldn't trust me, I saw that for her, I was another father-like figure. I was an authority figure in her life as a resident of the Institute, with me as the director of the Institute. I was a male authority figure that she also had trouble trusting. So you can see how her vision was colored by her own past experience, and my experience of her judgment, my experience of her comments about me, was colored by my desire, my hope, my expectation. Interesting how the human experience of one person interacts with the human experience of another person, and we hurt each other. Right? We make each other angry. So all this to say that It's important that we allow ourselves, that we know this is part of the human experience, and this is how we learn and grow as human beings, and that we allow ourselves to be present to what we're feeling, and to allow that energy to move.